So today let's take a look at a coffee machine and into a coffee machine, because this is what this channel is about. And this is a coffee machine my neighbor gave to me, and she said that it's not working, so I can try to repair it or keep it. It looks like a normal coffee machine, even though I'm not an expert on coffee machines because I don't drink coffee. Because when I drink coffee, I immediately fall asleep. I just can't drink it because I am so sleepy after a coffee. I just drink it and I sleep. So here's the coffee machine, which has quite a strange shape. It looks like a hen or a chicken. And I always wonder, is this huge machine necessary to make a coffee? Because you can also make it using a cup and a heater and some coffee powder. Or you can use a kettle instead of this dodgy device. And this one is quite huge and the shape of it is just ridiculous. How do you fit it on your table? If it was like a box, it can fit everywhere, but this strange shape doesn't fit anywhere. So I don't get why people use coffee machines, but I also don't get why people drink coffee at all. So I have to figure out how to use it, and you are probably going to be laughing at me. Basically, I don't even know how to use it, but I have to figure out how does it work and how to repair it, which is going to be interesting. And as far as I know, those machines are quite cheap, but those cartridges for them are quite expensive. And this one actually is for water, not for the cartridges. It's a cheap machine, but it uses bloody expensive cartridges, which reminds me of ink printers. I've got this old ink printer, which was about $60, and it was including the cartridges in it. And when they ran out and I have to buy new cartridges for it, those two cartridges alone were $60. So basically the entire printer, including the cartridges, is the same price as just those cartridges. So you basically get this printer for free and you just pay the price of those cartridges for it, which is just absolutely ridiculous. But of course you can refill those cartridges yourself using some cheap Chinese ink or even a bigger bottle of ink and some cleaning tools like this one and a syringe. So let's go back to this one. It has a water tank here with some valve here, and if you insert it here, it basically presses it like this and opens it. It's there to prevent the water from spilling when it's not in the machine. Here's the lid for it, and the water goes here. Here is the cable, and there is some warning, not for children from 0 to 12 years, and the liquid coming from it is hot, of course, so basically idiot proofing it. And what does it say? 220 to 240 volts, 50 or 60 hertz, 1340 to 1600 watts, and made in China, of course. It doesn't have many controls. Here's some selector, and it has three positions. Probably hot, medium, cold. But do you drink cold coffee, or can this one make a cold coffee? I don't know. And when you put it in the middle, you can open it like this. And there is some handle. When you open it, you can remove this tray for the cartridges. So you basically put the cartridge into this tray, put it in the machine, close it, choose hot or cold, and it probably makes the coffee. And the coffee comes from this hole and into your cup. Even though this cup is probably too big for a coffee, it's my cup for a tea. And here seems to be a needle in it, which makes a hole in the cartridge. Here's the needle, which is actually quite sharp, and there is a warning that the needle can actually go into your finger, basically. And it makes a hole in this cartridge, and And the hot water probably comes into the cartridge and it comes out through the other side of it. Is there a hole in it or not? And is it open from this side? Even though if it's opened, it can spill before you use it. Or does it make another hole here? That's weird. Or does it like spill over? Does it open this hole or not? And that's weird. And my kit is probably going to help me figure it out. What do you think about it? So I really don't know how the machine is supposed to open the hole at the bottom of the cartridge. And that's weird. Because the bottom of the machine has just this hole, but there is no mechanism to open it or make a hole in it from the bottom. So the water comes in through the needle, but how does it come out? Because if the hole is already open from the manufacturer, why doesn't it spill out? And it actually seems to be kind of puffed. Even the air doesn't come out. So is it sealed, and how does the machine unseal it? And there is absolutely no mechanism at the bottom of it to break the seal. So I don't know how does it work, but now let's try to turn it on and test it. So I've put some water in it and now it's probably going to get messy. Let's put the lid on it, the cartridge in it, close it, set it to hot, put some cup under it and turn it on. No explosion. And what's happening now? Is it running? It's set to hot. It's closed. And nothing. And does it have to heat up? So let's wait. It doesn't do anything. So let's try to measure the power of it. How much does it draw? 0.4 watts? 0.3. It's just very little. It seems to be completely dead. And this is virtually no power. It's supposed to draw about 1600 watts. So I guess the heater in it is open circuit, or maybe there is a blown fuse or a thermal fuse. Even though maybe it's a good idea to try to press this switch on the other side of it. Pressing it. And it's blinking red. And the power of it is still about almost 0 watts. So what's happening? Virtually no power. There must be some problem. Or well, now it seems to do something. Now it's green. Now it actually started to draw some power. About 40 watts. Does it run or not? Nothing is coming out. It's kind of vibrating. That's odd. What it's doing? Vibrating. Buzzing. No coffee coming out. Not a single drop. It's hot. Cold. Still 40 watts. So this is probably off. This should be hot and cold. And this is the power switch. And that's weird. So is it broken or is it just because I don't know how to use it? I don't know. What if I run it with no cartridge? Still the same. And not a single drop of coffee coming out. No, it was just very briefly drawing about 1400 watts. Quite a lot of power, but then it came back down to about 40 watts. And still not a single drop of coffee, so let's take a look in it. And bloody hell, here's the screw which is like a star with a pin in the center. So let's try to put my flat screwdriver in it. Is it going to fit? Somehow? Okay, it seems to somehow work. Yeah, nice. The screw looks like this. It's the annoying type of screw which is designed to prevent you from opening it. But let's open it anyway. No problem using a flat screwdriver, guys. It just works fine. Like this. So that's it. Now this part should probably come out. Yes. It's out and you can see the internals. So let's take a look at it. Here's the water inlet with some hose going probably into the pump. And the mains comes in here. And this one is probably the ground connected using this screw, and there are some thermal fuses probably. It says 10 amps, 133 degrees Celsius. Okay, it's a current fuse and a thermal fuse probably in one, and it's in both neutral and live. And then it goes, one of them goes into the control board here, and the other one goes to the heater. So this one probably is a heater, this metal part. And here's one connection of it, and the other is at the bottom of it. And there is some temperature sensor probably, and it goes into the control board. And the control board contains some, probably some interference filter, some filter capacitor, and this one is probably a triac. So it seems to have a triac regulation, probably for the heater. And there must be some control circuitry, some chip maybe from the other side. And there is even some program interface. It says program. That's interesting. This connection says heater. This is most likely the triac. And some other connection. Capsule holder, valve. So it seems like the heater is temperature regulated. There is a triac regulation for it and some temperature sensor for thermal feedback. And the heater says 230 volts, 1400 watts. So let's try to open it further. I removed two screws from here and now it still doesn't open. So do I have to remove this cover? No screws under it. And what about the other? Still no screws. And from the bottom, no screws visible, and those legs are, does it have some screw under it? No screw. That's weird. Here's the mains cable. There is also no screw here. And there is something like, it looks like it clicks in. It probably somehow clicks in. Can I unclick it? It's not easy to open. And that's it. And the same process from the other side, probably. So the bottom comes off, but I can't open it like this because there is a lot of connections and hoses, and some of them comes off and the water spills out of it, which is nice. And the heater is somehow mounted to the bottom plate of it. Can I remove it? Does it just click in? I'm not sure, but I can see no screw. Okay, I probably have to turn it to remove it. It seems to work. And it comes to bits. Here's the mains in. And this is the water inlet. Which goes into the pump here. And here's the output of the pump, which seems to go into two directions. One goes into the heater, and the other one goes directly into the top of it. So it seems like there is this valve choosing from cold or hot water. So the water from the pump can go either through the heater or directly to this nozzle. So it doesn't look so complicated. There is a water pump, there is the heater with some thermal fuses and some thermistor for temperature sensing. And that's it. There is a track regulation for the heater and some control circuitry, and here's the valve choosing from hot or cold. And is there anything else in the top of it? Let's try to open it further. That was easy. Here's the valve with some springs. That's weird. And it also controls some switch here. It looks like a three position switch. Nice. So let's remove the rest of the red cover. Okay, it's gone. Here you can see the nice switch. And a valve, probably. Can I remove this one? No screws here. But it's kind of strange because you could get cold water by just turning this heater off. You don't have to mechanically switch those hoses. That's weird. So is this one a valve or just a switch? I'm not sure. And there is some heavy duty metal shaft in it. That's weird. Interesting. Now does it fall apart? It still doesn't. And so it seems like I'm definitely not going to put it back together, but I don't need it anyway. And the top of it seems like the most complex part of it. The most crazy part of it. There are some gears. And that's odd. It looks like a one-way gear. So this valve actually works by squeezing the hoses here. And this plastic part actually squeezes it here to close it or open it. And the same applies to the other one. So it actually squeezes one or the other to choose cold or hot. But it's probably the cheapest way to make a valve, of course. So the top of it is just an overcomplicated mechanism to close it and open it. Here's the nozzle or needle going into the cartridge. the two hoses, the valve, and a mechanical switch connected to it with three wires going into the control board. And here's the board with the power button, and the board probably just clicks into it. Does it come out? No, it comes out. It has some white plastic on it. Can I get the board out somehow? Let's remove some connectors here and take it out. Can I just pry it out? And that's it. Here's the switch with the light guide and the micro switch here and the LED, red and green. And I can see some microcontroller, some resistors, capacitors, a tiny transistor, some diodes, some power transistor, or maybe a small triac, I'm not sure. And that's more or less it. And from the other side, there is some interference filter with capacitors, some power resistors, a diode, a filter capacitor for the microcontroller. And there is no switching power supply and no transformer, so the power for the chip is probably generating using a capacitive dropper. So one of those capacitors is an interference filter and the other is just the capacitive dropper for the control circuitry. A metal oxide varistor for an overvoltage protection. And here's the main triac on the heatsink in the triac regulation. So this is more or less the control board of it. And it looks like there is a big triac for the heater and this one is a small triac for the pump. So there are two triacs for those two power parts in it. And here's the microcontroller. And here's the triac, the small one. And the big one, BT137-800. Here is the only electrolytic capacitor in it. And this bigger yellow capacitor is the capacitive dropper with its discharging resistor and an inrush resistor. And the smaller one is the interference filter. And there is some other sensor in the top of it. Probably sensing if it's closed or opened. Its connector says capsule holder. And here's the pump in it, which looks like a big electromagnet. It has two terminals of probably a coil and there is some fuse on it, probably also a thermal fuse. And it doesn't look like a motor, so it really looks like an electromagnet which is vibrating some piston or membrane, pumping the water. And should I try to turn it on like this? It's probably not a good idea, but well, let's see what happens. So now it's partially back together. The water tank is here and of course it's leaking. And now let's try to run it. 3, 2, 1, boom. Let's try to turn it on. Do this. Is it pumping? Bloody hell! So the breaker is tripped and it sparked somewhere here and this hose is blown off. I'm not sure what happened, but bloody hell, it's hot. Okay, this hose basically was blown off this pipe. There is this pipe and the hose just came off somehow, probably by an overpressure. So it seems like it's clogged somewhere, probably by the minerals from water, and so it pressurized and it burst. It basically blown off this pipe. And accidentally, this metal spring on this hose made a short circuit between this metal body of the heater and some of those terminals here on the pump. Here you can see the mark on it from the short circuit. And there is also a mark on this spring here and here. So where it's stuck, let's test it using a syringe, connecting it to the heater. And this one seems to be okay. This one is not clogged. Now testing the pump, connecting the syringe to the output of it. Let's suck. It works, but it doesn't go the other way. So there is a one-way valve in it. So the pump is okay. So if the heater is not blocked, the pump is not blocked, what is blocked in it? Is it the nozzle in the top of it? So let's remove the hose from the nozzles and let's try to inject water in it using a syringe again. And does the water come out? Oh, now it's blown off. So it's probably impossible. And no matter the position of the valve, it doesn't work. And the other one? Oh, bloody hell, this is the wrong pipe. The wrong hose. Okay. And there are those two pipes which are, one is the cold and the other one is the hot. And it's blocked. And this one is also blocked. So it looks like this needle is blocked. Maybe. So here you can see the two hoses coming to the nozzle or needle. They're connected with some piece of plastic and then it goes into the needle here. Can I somehow remove the needle from it? And this part comes off with the needle here and now let's try to test it. And yes, the needle is blocked completely. So there is some minerals from the water stuck in the needle, or maybe remains of the coffee are stuck in it. And the hoses are clogged or not. Seems okay. Yeah, the hoses are okay. So let's just poke the needle using a wire. And it comes through from the other side. And now it should be okay. Nice. So let's try to give it one more try. Set it to hot, turn it on. And it seems to do something. Does it make a coffee? Maybe. Even though it's slightly spilling, that's very dodgy. The water is spilling everywhere. Well, it does something. That's nice. Not sure is it coffee or just water. So the main problem probably was the blocked needle here. But I'm not going to continue repairing it because I don't need it. And it's also way too dodgy because it's leaking where I was disconnecting those hoses. But as you can see, it would be repairable just by poking the needle here. But the main point of this video was to see how does it work, not repairing it, of course. And here's the schematic of it. It's a partial schematic without the control circuitry. And the control circuitry is a bit too complex, so I didn't draw it. So the mains comes in, there are those fuses, this interference capacitor, a metal oxide varistor for overvoltage protection, here's the heater with its triac, It's the big one. Here's the pump with its small triac and another fuse in series. There is some mains voltage sensing probably going into the control circuitry. Here's the NTC thermistor for temperature sensing, and this one is mounted on the heater. It's grounded. Here's the valve switch sensing the position of the valve. Here's some other sensor on the capsule holder, probably sensing if it's closed or opened. Here's the button and the LED with two colors. So those triacs are basically switching those loads, or maybe the heater is even regulated, not just switched. And there is the power supply for the control circuitry, and it's a capacitive dropper with a capacitor, an inrush resistor, and a discharging resistor for this capacitor. And there is just a single half cycle rectification, rectifying just one half cycle of the mains, which is less efficient because it uses just half of the current through this capacitor, but it has one important advantage. The power of the control circuitry has a common rail with mains, and this allows the control circuitry to directly control those triacs. The gates of those triacs can be directly connected with the control circuitry. So a capacitive dropper with a single half cycle rectification requires double the capacity of the capacitor because it uses just one half cycle, but it has a common rail, so it can directly control those triacs. And it uses a negative voltage, probably minus 5 volts or something like this, because most of the triacs are actually easier to control with a negative voltage. The gates of the triacs are more sensitive in the negative polarity. And most of the triacs work in just 3 quadrants, not all 4 of them. So it uses a negative current, because the missing quadrant is when the gate is positive and the main voltage is negative. And there is a Zener diode for voltage regulation, but it also doubles up as a rectifying diode. In the positive half cycle the voltage drop is very low, like 1 volt, but in the negative half cycle the voltage drop is the Zener voltage, which is I guess about 5 volts. And this negative 5 volts is rectified by this diode and smoothed by this capacitor. I guess the voltage on the Zener looks about like this. So this is Dark and Wild, and see you in my next videos, and thanks to all of my patrons on Patreon, I really appreciate your support. This is so disgusting! Oh my god! And I also plan to take a look at this amazing device. It's a Torricelli barometer, or a mercury stick barometer. It's basically a wooden plank about 1 meter long with a glass tube on it, filled with mercury, and it shows you the atmospheric pressure in millimeters of mercury. And it also shows you the weather forecast.